Welcome to today's lecture. I'm very happy to announce Professor Cinzia Ruzza, a philosopher and feminist activist. She teaches at the New School for Social Research in New York and is also the co-organizer of many of the recent feminist strikes. Among other of her books, she authored Dangerous Lesions, The Marriage and Divorce of Marxism and Feminism, and also recently, together with Titi Bhattacharya and Nancy Fraser, she authored Feminists for the 99% Manifesto, which was recently translated into Croatian and published by the Multimedia Institute and the Center for Women's Studies. So besides today's lecture, there were also going to be another one tomorrow at the Center for Women's Studies under the title Resisting the Charm of Capitalism from Progressive Neoliberalism to Universal Liberation. I'm not sure if there's still space, so you need to check. However, the title of today's lecture is Beyond the Logic of Parallel Movements, the Third Feminist Wave as a Class Formation. So after the lecture, there will be room for questions. And now, please help me welcome Cinzia Ruzza.
Thank you very much for the invitation, in particular to Carolina for coordinating everything. So today I'm going to speak a lot about class, but it's going to be a feminist lecture. First of all, what I'm going to present today is basically the beginning of a new project, which I hope to develop first into an article, but then also possibly in a few years into a book on class and class struggle, so a feminist book on class struggle. One of the reasons why I decided to work on this topic is that I thought that one way to go beyond the usual debate about, you know, primary or secondary contradiction, whether a class is primary or not compared to gender or to race, and so on, maybe we should rather make a step back and ask ourselves what a class is and what class struggle actually means, and whether the question if class struggle is primary compared to feminist struggle is actually the wrong question to ask. And being the wrong question to ask can only lead to wrong answers. So what I'm going to present today is a first attempt to think about ways in which we could reconceptualize class struggle in such a way that we see gender struggles and feminist struggle as a constitutive part, necessary part of a process of class formation. And by process, and I will explain what I mean for class formation, and I will also explain why I think it is today a process of class formation toward a form of class struggle that is immediately inherently feminist, anti-racist, and internationalist. So I'm going to start with Lise Vogel's book, Marxism and the Oppression of Women, which was published originally, I think, in 1984, but was recently republished by Historical Materialism and Haymarket. And this book is somehow one of the foundational texts for social reproduction theory and for Marxist feminism. It is one of the most accomplished, in spite of the fact that it has its own limits, but it's one of the most accomplished attempts at giving an explanation of the structural relation between capitalism and gender oppression. So with the, using the notion of social reproduction and challenging dualistic views of patriarchy and capitalism. Now, in the chapter titled The Dual Legacy, Lise Vogel underlines how the socialist tradition has historically been characterized by two contradictory approaches to women's oppression. On the one hand, among authors and revolutionary leaders such as Clara Zetkin or Lenin, we see the beginning of an elaboration of the constitutive role of women's oppression under capitalism and its reproduction by capitalist relations of production. On the other hand, a parallel tendency developed an implicitly dualistic approach to gender oppression based on Engels' ambiguous formulations in the origin of the family, private property, and the state. This latter dualistic approach to the interpretation of class exploitation and sexual oppression is implicitly present throughout the history of European socialism and has characterized the majority of organizations belonging to the Second International, but was only developed into an explicit and systematic theory only in the 70s with the elaboration of the, in the Anglophone debate, of dual systems theory. According to this perspective, so according to dual systems theory, the oppression of women and class exploitation should be seen as two distinct and discrete phenomena, so as two different systems of relations of power and exploitation, which should be analyzed separately, but also together in their reciprocal combination. So the idea is basically that under capitalism, we still have a system called patriarchy that remains under capitalism and that interacts and combines with capitalism in specific ways. But basically, if we want to understand why women are still oppressed under capitalism, we need to refer to this notion of patriarchy. So we need to analyze patriarchy as a system. So in this sense, Vogel speaks about dualistic approach, because we are speaking about two systems rather than only one. So for example, in Vogel's analysis of August Bebel's book, Woman and Socialism, and of Edward Aveling's pamphlet, The Female Question, Vogel emphasizes the limitations of an eclectic theoretical approach that leads to contradictory and implicitly dualistic positions. This not only affects the analysis of capitalist society, but also have consequences from the point of view of political strategy and the conception of class struggle. Indeed, according to Vogel, Aveling and Bebel, Bebel's lack of a robust theoretical elaboration of the relationship between capitalism and women's oppression led to theoretical and political oscillations between, on the one hand, the idea that the socialist revolution would be the final solution to women's problems, and on the other, a strategy of parallel movements, so feminist struggle and class struggle, which represented the common sense of the organizations belonging to the Second International. Both Aveling and Bebel tended to consider the issue of women's oppression from the viewpoint of equal rights and economic and legal independence from men, a tendency present in Engels, too. The paradox resulting from these positions was as follows. On the one hand, we see the development of the idea that only the socialist revolution can liberate women from their specific oppression, such that the final liberation of women is treated as a kind of utopian future. So in other words, let's dismantle capitalism and then we will all be free. On the other, the struggle of and for women in a capitalist context is fundamentally conceptualized as a struggle for equal rights between women and men, a position that is difficult to distinguish from liberal feminism. This paradoxical formulation thus retains no connection between the utopian perspective of a future without oppression and the strategies of struggle today against and within capitalism. And I would say also that this dualistic approach is also the origin of a certain understanding of class struggle as basically genderless or sex blind, and therefore of all the various theorizations about the various hierarchies of priorities. So class struggle comes first, then anti-colonial struggle, then women's struggle, and so on and so on. What is particularly interesting in Vogel's analysis is the way she connects theoretical dualism with reformist political strategy. Reformist currents within the Second International could well adapt to an idea of class exploitation and the oppression of women as discrete and parallel phenomena, adopt the universal category of woman as a starting point, and on this basis fight for equality of formal rights between men and women. Revolutionaries like Zetkin and Lenin, instead, largely rejected the universal categories of woman or the family as theoretical starting points, and they focused instead on the specificity of women's oppression in relation to their class position within a given mode of production. Despite their theoretical nuance, however, neither Zetkin nor Lenin came up with a systematic and coherent theory on this subject. Now, in the second part of her book, Vogel develops her own unitary theory. So in other words, she develops a theory of social reproduction in I'm not going to have the time to speak here about social reproduction, but I will speak about this tomorrow when I will speak about sexuality and the social reproduction of sexuality. But basically, she identifies in social reproduction, that is the work and activities and institutions that reproduce labor power, understood not just as the individual labor power, but as the reproduction of a whole class. So the whole working class, she identifies in the organization of social reproduction and its subordination to production for profits, the structural elements that contribute in a decisive way to reproduce gender oppression under capitalism. So in other words, if we want to understand why, in spite of all the promises of individual freedom and self-emancipation that capitalism has made to us, women are still oppressed under capitalism. The answer to this question is not that there are still remnants from previous societies. So, for example, from previous patriarchal societies that capitalism has not overcome with yet, but rather that there are very specific dynamics within capitalism that generates the condition, the framework, for and the push in the direction have as a consequence the reproduction of gender oppression. So social reproduction is basically the key social sphere that can help us explain us why this is the case. Now, while she does do this work, and she works with Marx, in particular with Marx's Capital, to analyze what is missing in Marx's Capital and supplement what is missing in Marx's Capital in order to explain the necessary connection between contemporary gender oppression and capitalism, what she doesn't do is to revise theories of class in light of social reproduction theory. So in other words, what is missing from her book is basically an alternative understanding of what class struggle is, based on social reproduction and unitary theory, and therefore a political alternative to the dualism she criticizes in the Second International. So what I want to start doing is precisely to articulate this this part that is missing in her book. And I want to do this also because social reproduction theory is clearly a theory that is developing and evolving. It was quite prominent in the 60s and 70s, and then it declined and disappeared from the, more or less disappeared from the scene for several decades, and now it's back. But this means that there are several elements that are still missing in social reproduction theory. So, for example, there isn't a full-fledged theory of gender violence connected to social reproduction. There isn't. There is at the beginning of a reflection on sexuality and social reproduction. There isn't much still on race and social reproduction. And again, there is no class theory. So, in other words, there is no. There isn't a proper social reproduction theory class idea. One exception is an article by Titi Bhattacharya, How Not to Skip Class, which is in her, in the volume she edited on social reproduction theory. But basically, this is the only text that addresses the issue of what counts as class struggle. So my aim today is to begin this work. And one of the reasons why I think it is urgent that social reproduction theory develops this work is the fact that we are in the middle of an incredibly powerful feminist wave, transnational feminist wave, which has very specific characteristics. First of all, the use of strikes as a means of struggle, but also as a form of self-identification and politicization. And precisely this new feminist wave requires us to respond in a creative and non-dogmatic way to two fundamental questions. The first is precisely, what is a class? And the second, what is the relationship between class struggle and the new feminist movement? Okay, so I'm going to skip social reproduction and we'll start with class. Now, in spite of the fact that the notion of class is quite central to Marxist theory, actually it's probably the central, together with capital is the central notion, it is quite unclear what a class is within Marxist theory. In other words, what we have within the Marxist tradition is a series of competing definitions of what counts as class and class struggle. And the problem arises with Marx himself. Why? Because in spite of his statement that all human history is history of class struggle, Marx doesn't really give us a definition of class. So in other words, we do not have a single definition and coherent definition of class in Marx's work. We have several hints, different and competing definitions. And this ambiguity, of course, then played a role in the subsequent Marxist tradition. So just to give you an example, in Marxist writings, class sometimes, especially in the early writings, but not only, sometimes resembles a sort of metaphysical entity or a moment of a philosophy of history leading to the negation of negation and the realm of freedom. So the proletariat that has nothing to lose but its chain, and that is the negation of negation, and so on. At other times, Marx seems to identify very narrowly class, the working class, with the industrial working class, so with a specific form of working class, and therefore seems to define what class is on the basis of objective economic and sociological criteria, particularly the criterion of the placement within the relations of production. So basically, what is the working class is the class of industrial workers who are exploited by capitalists under capital. So it is the class of workers from which value and surplus value is pumped and so on. In The Poverty of Philosophy, Marx distinguishes in a very famous formula between class in itself and class for itself, a phrase that had some success in the strategic debate within socialist and communist political currents, but that is not articulated further in Marx or in Marx's work. In other words, we do find the phrase, but then we don't know exactly what the phrase is supposed to mean. And finally, sometimes, as in the 18 Brumaire, Marx seems not to consider class as a social group without its politically acting as a class. So in other words, the quantitative sociological criterion, so what place do you occupy within relations of production, is not sufficient to define what a class is. The famous sentence in the 18 Brumaire is the sentence on the French peasants, which Marx defined not as a class, precisely. He denies they are a class, and he calls them a sack of potatoes. And why does he call them a sack of potatoes? Because they are not acting politically as a class. They do not have the political agency of a class. And therefore, for this reason, they are co-opted by Louis Napoleon and Bonaparte, and therefore form the social basis of Bonapartism. So these ambiguities were inherited by the subsequent Marxist tradition and have characterized a debate which often was divided between what we may call objectivist interpretations of what a class is and political interpretations. So in other words, between interpretations insisting on objective and quantifiable criteria, such as the position occupied within the relations of production, income level, autonomy in the workplace, status, and so on, as necessary and sufficient conditions for the identification and distinction among social classes, and interpretations emphasizing the dimension of social and political subjectivity as an essential but not sufficient criterion for the definition of class. So in other words, on the one hand, we have the tendency to identify class with the workforce, and then with variations within this within this approach based on issues like level of income, status, and so on. On the other hand, there are some Marxist tendencies that have actually insisted more on the fundamental criterion of political agency. So we can speak of a class only if we are witnessing the political agency of a class subjectivity. Now, in what follows, I'm going to focus on this last line of interpretation, because it is this line of interpretation that allows us to reformulate in a more creative way what class struggle means, and therefore also to avoid the usual debate between class struggle and feminist struggle, especially in relation to the current feminist wave. And I'm going to refer especially to the works of E.P. Thompson, Ellen Maxis Wood, Daniel Ben Said, and David McNally, although part of the work of my work when I will expand this paper will be also to refer to the Italian tradition of operaismo, especially the early operaismo of the 60s and 70s, and in particular the notion of class composition within Italian operaismo, which is quite, it has differences but has some elements of strong similarity with the notion of class formation in Thompson. So, after the publication of his book on the making of the English working class, E.P. Thompson was criticized because of the methodological introduction that opens the book. He was accused of ignoring objective class relations in his presentation of class as the product of historical process that could be called subjectivation, although this is not the term that Thompson uses. And this is the reason why Thompson, Maxine Wood, and other authors of this tendency have been called, like Bob Brenner, political Marxist. Political Marxism is a label that was actually not created by the author, these authors themselves, but rather by the those who were criticizing these authors, and it was basically precisely a critique, you know, political Marxist in the sense you don't take into account the structure, you don't take into account the relations of production. So in other words, just to explain what the critique was about, Thompson was accused of having a subjectivist, contingent, and voluntaristic conception of class, which would not take into account the structural objective determination of classes. This misunderstanding was due in part to the fact that in his introduction, Thompson does not systematically clarify the concept he uses, because his work at the end of the day is a historical work, not a theoretical one. However, in a later article published in 1978, 18th Century English Society, Class Struggle Without Class, Thompson articulates his theoretical conception of class in a more systematic and clear manner. So I'm going to refer to this article. So what Thompson says is, first of all, class is primarily a historical category. The category of class must be derived from the observation of concrete individual and collective behaviors, which over time manifest a class character and create class institutions. So, for example, unions, parties, and other kinds of, you know, labor organizations, and so on. In other words, a theory of class cannot be articulated at the expense of historical observation and its results. Being a historical category, class is a dynamic notion that refers to a process and not to a static essence. And this is a fundamental difference from a sociological approach that thinks that it can give a valid definition of class for all eras on the basis of classificatory and quantitative criteria. So, for example, all those who belong to the workforce. On the contrary, for Thompson, the notion of class struggle takes precedence over the notion of class, both from a theoretical and from a historical point of view. Class, according to Thompson, is the product of class struggle and not the other way around. Because one can speak of classes only within an antagonistic relationship between social groups that articulate class behaviors in and through their struggle against each other. Daniel Ben Said articulates a position quite similar to that of Thompson when he criticizes the sociological conception of class in Marx for Our Times. This is the English title of Marx and Tempestive. Here, Ben Said argues that Marx does not understand class as an entity that can be studied and defined in isolation. For classes can be analyzed only within their antagonistic dynamics with other classes. Classes are therefore social relations and not static essences or objects. This perspective still raises the question of the economic and structural basis for the definition of a social group as a class. So in other words, at this level of the definition, we may still wonder, okay, but then everything can become a class through the struggle. So every kind of social grouping can become class through its struggle. So from this viewpoint, it is useful to refer to, the defense and clarification of Thompson's position by Ellen Maxine Wood. In an article published in 1982, The Politics of Theory and the Concept of Class, Maxine Wood argues that in order to understand Thompson's position, one must clarify the distinction between what she calls class situations on the one hand and class formations on the other. So in other words, social relations of production structure society by placing individuals in class situations, the nature of which is determined by objective factors. So in other words, clearly, capitalist social relations structure society by creating social hierarchies, placing individuals in different positions within this social hierarchy, and this social hierarchy is determined by objective criterion. So for example, if I don't have means of production, I have to work for a wage, and if I have to work for a wage, but I cannot find a job, and so on, all of these are objective objective factors, which place me in a class situation. Yet, these objective structural determinations must be conceived as historical forces acting in a historical way and not as theoretical constructs that mechanically impose themselves upon history. That is, individuals who are placed in class situations are not passive materials devoid of history, cultural traditions, bonds preceding their class situation, but rather they're actors who relate to their class situation in a historically located and therefore variable way. Moreover, one's placement in a class situation does not, by the same token, entail their experience of belonging to a class. Class relations are not automatically present in a class situation and are thus not immediately accessible to lived experience. So in other words, I can be placed in a class situation but not perceive myself as belonging to this given class. And this is not just a matter of consciousness, as I will explain, it is a matter of experience. And that has to do with the processes of struggle on the one hand, but also objective factors on the other. If we look at the workforce, one of the problems about conflating class with the workforce is the fact that taken as a workforce, workers are actually individuals in competition with each other. So they are in competition on the labor market, they're in competition to find jobs, and they're putting in this competition among each other by objective situation, by objective class, relations understood in a sociological way. So how do they become a class then? That acts as a class, so that acts in antagonism, in a struggle against another class. Maxine Wood clarifies this point with reference to workplaces and production sites. What workers in the same factory experience is not their class, is not immediately their class, and are not the relations of production in general. What they experience is their own conditions of life and work within that given particular productive unit, which brings them together in the same place and at the same time. So they are gathered together, objectively, not in a class, but in a productive unity, in a workplace, in a factory, in a call center, and so on. Of course, their objective placement with regard to the relations of production creates the conditions of possibility for them to transcend the level of their individual productive unit and experience a higher class unity than their mere assembly together. But this superior unit is neither a mechanical product nor a faithful image of the partition of society by the relations of production. It is the product of a situated and variable historical process which Maxine Wood calls class formation, as opposed to class situation. for workers to form a class, it is necessary to struggle as a class. So basically, if I work in a call center, what I immediately experience is my exploitation and horrible working condition in my own call center. If I'm a woman, I will probably also experience sexual harassment and other forms of abuse related to my gender. If I'm a racialized person, I will probably, together with my exploitation and the repetitive job, I will also experience racism, marginalization, unequal pay, and so on and so on. I do not have an immediate experience of belonging to a class. My lived experience is that of my concrete situation. However, relations of production do exist. So in other words, I'm having this experience in this call center, but other workers are having a similar experience in another call center or in a factory, in another workplace, and so on. So there is the possibility of forming or recognizing ourselves as part of a larger unity, but this possibility is never the outcome of an automatic mechanical process. And it is always the outcome of a very complicated process that entails struggle, experimentation, experiencing larger form, higher forms of unity, and so on and so on. So all this complicated process is what Maxine Wood calls class formation, which includes the concrete experience of antagonism, the development of class consciousness, but it cannot be reduced to a question of consciousness or ideology. So it's not just a matter of, you know, knowing that I belong to a class in terms of, you know, being, for example, educated by groups of activists who will explain this to me. A class is therefore not a static entity, but a social relation and a political grouping which is configured in historically specific and contingent ways. Now, in spite of their apparent similarities, this conception should not be confused with traditional interpretations of the famous phrase by Marx that I quoted earlier, that is, you know, the class for itself, and the class in itself and the class for itself. Why? Because this famous formula very often has been interpreted in the sense that class already exists as a given entity. So the class in itself is the essence, let's say, the hidden essence. It's already there. And it is determined by structural factors. What it needs to do is just needs to become aware of itself. So it just needs to acquire class consciousness, self-consciousness. And therefore, class for itself is just the manifestation of this hidden essence that is already there. So as David McNally explained in a recent article, the problem of defining class in terms of an abstract universal essence, for example, the totality of the labor force, or the totality of those who have been expropriated of means of production, is not that this definition is entirely false. There is some truth in this definition, but the problem is that it represents a unilateral, incomplete, and impoverished approach to the question of class. Because it is an approach that does not allow us to see the complex process of self-constitution that takes place between class in itself and class for itself. So in other words, between class in itself and class for itself, there is not the moment of enlightenment which allows this essence to become manifest to itself. There is this historical, complicated, messy process of class formation, which requires the experience of struggle. Understood this way, class in itself represents only the most vague and precarious determination of class, which corresponds to what Maxine Wood calls class situation, a determination that risks presenting class as a thing instead of a dynamic social relation. Now, why am I insisting on this definition of class, and what does this have to do with feminism and the feminist wave? I'm insisting on this because if we take class not as a given essence, but rather as the outcome of a historical process of self-constitution, based, of course, on objective social relations. So we are not, you know, I'm not Laclau, so I'm not suggesting that class is an empty signifier and we can regroup around it. There are objective relations of production that situate people in class situations. But if we understand class in this way, then, first of all, There is enormous, we need to recognize that there is enormous variability historically in the way in which the class forms itself, in the way in which it struggles, and in the way in which the antagonist manifests itself. Therefore, if there is this variability, we cannot have preconstituted models of what counts as class struggle, and we cannot look at reality thinking that what happens in reality must correspond to the model we have in our mind. Rather, we should operate the other way around, which is to look at the struggles that are currently taking place, the really existing struggles, not the ones we wish, see whether these struggles present a class character or not. So my hypothesis is that the new feminist wave is precisely such a struggle. So in other words, that at least in a number of countries, not everywhere because it's an uneven process, that at least in some countries, the new feminist wave has a class character and is a process of class formation. So that the question of asking what is the relationship, how can we relate this feminist wave to the workers' movement, to class struggle, is the wrong question to ask. Why? Because this feminist movement is already class struggle, but it is class struggle of a very different character, with very different features compared to the image, which never corresponded really to reality, but to the image of class struggle as the industrial male working class and so on, fighting for wages. So now I'm going to the feminist movement, and I'm going to give some examples and explain why I think that this feminist wave has these characteristics. On October 23rd in Glasgow, thousands of women workers in the cleaning sector began a strike to demand equal pay between men and women in their domain of work. Only a week after this event, October 23rd of last year, only a week after this event, thousands of Google workers from Tokyo to New York left their workplaces and took to the streets to protest against sexual harassment at Google. The protest also called for protection and trade union rights. One of the slogans of the New York protest said, "Worker rights are women's rights." And there was obviously a reason for this, because clearly sexual harassment within the workplace has to do with the labor rights. So in other words, in workplaces where workers have fewer rights, in which hierarchies are stronger, relations of power are more brutal, clearly there are greater conditions for sexual harassment and for impunity for sexual harassment. Not only this, but sexual harassment is also used as a form of discipline of women workers within workplaces. So these two strikes were, at the time when I wrote the first version of this paper, the latest in a long series of women strikes, or women worker-led strikes, from the international feminist strikes of March 8, the last one this year, to those women workers in the hospitality and education sectors in the United States between last year and this year. Women's strikes, or strikes against gender violence or the wage gap, pose fundamental questions. So if we adopt the logic of parallel movements as the interpretative approach to these events, the temptation is to read these strikes either as class struggle or as feminist movement, or as an alliance between the two. What this logic fails to grasp is the fact that the new feminist wave is questioning the separation between these categories. From this point of view, the Glasgow and Google strikes, as well as the March 8 international strikes, are better understood, in my view, as feminist class struggle. The new feminist wave is developing more and more as a process of class formation, formation of a class subjectivity with specific characteristics. It is immediately anti-neoliberal, internationalist, anti-racist, with anti-capitalist tendencies, and of course, feminist. While the second feminist wave in the 60s and 70s had its core in a set of advanced capitalist Western countries, the current feminist wave was born from the periphery, from Argentina and Poland, and has rapidly expanded to a global level, taking on a massive dimension in a series of countries most affected by financial crisis, by austerity and debt control policies, Not by chance, one of the slogans of the Argentine feminist movement last year was, the original slogan was, we want ourselves alive, and then they supplemented the slogan, we want ourselves alive and free of debt, in response to the new debt crisis in Argentina, and the way in which the right-wing government is managing it. These are countries where social reproduction has been particularly affected by the financial crisis. The use of digital technologies and social media has contributed immensely to the immediate transnational nature of the movement, encouraging not only the coordination of the struggle, but also the circulation of documents, articles, ideas, slogans, analysis, and information, encouraging a dynamic expansion of the mobilization. So this year, for example, we had the expansion of the movement to new countries. For example, Chile organized its first feminist strike, Belgium organized its and Germany organized the first feminist strikes, and we will have the first feminist strike in Switzerland on June 14th, so in a few days. But it is above all the strike that constitutes the most important novelty of the new feminist wave. Not only because the strike has placed women's work and the role of women's social reproduction at the center of the debate, but also because it has become the main driving force behind the process of subjectivation, through which a new anti-capitalist feminist subjectivity, strongly critical of liberal feminism, is developing. Now, the potential impact of the current process of feminist subjectivation emerges most clearly when one takes into account the fundamental difference between this wave and the first two. In extremely schematic terms, the first feminist wave, in the last decades of the 19th and early 20th centuries, took place within the process of birth and consolidation of the workers' movement. From the growth of the German social democracy to the formation of trade unions, and social democratic and communist parties throughout Europe and the United States. So within this historical process of mass politicization and the eruption of the working class on the political scene, the first feminist wave claimed the full realization of the universalist promise proper to both democratic liberalism and to socialism by agitating around the slogan of equality, equality of capabilities and of rights. The second feminist wave took place within another process of class subjectivation, that of the onset of the new left in advanced capitalist countries, and of the wave of anti-colonial and national liberation struggles. Within this process, the second wave appropriated the watchword of difference, borrowed especially from black nationalism and from the anti-colonial struggle, to denounce sexism in society and within the movement, and to give voice and visibility to a specificity too often silenced. Now, the context of the third feminist wave is radically different, since the new feminist movement is not the expression of a particularism within a broader process of subjectivation. In other words, we are not today in a phase of ascent of class struggle worldwide in a coordinated way, comparable to, you know, the birth of the workers' movement in between the end of the 19th century, early 20th century, or compared to the new left and the anti-colonial struggle from the 50s to the 70s. There are obviously struggles around the world, and there are also mass mobilizations from Algeria or to Sudan and so on, but clearly, we are in a situation in which we are actually starting coming out of 4 decades of withdrawal from struggle, from class, and 4 decades of neoliberal attack. Now, the explosion of the feminist movement was, of course, preceded by other mobilizations, and in particular by the season of movements between 2011 and 2013. So, in particular, the Occupy movement, the Indignados in Spain, Taksim Square in Turkey, and the Arab revolutions. And it does have some elements of continuity with these movements that preceded it, the birth of this wave. Like these previous movements, the feminist movement was born mostly outside of and independent from all the parties and organizations of the traditional left. And as in 2011, 2013, one of the characteristics of the feminist movement is the speed with which specific and partial claims, for example, the denunciation of femicides or the resistance to the attack on the on abortion rights, have transformed into an overall condemnation of the system, so the capitalist mode of production as a whole and its state institutions. However, the anti-systemic nature of the 2011-2013 mobilizations was not matched either by a capacity for organizational sedimentation or by an ability to identify practices or struggles, struggling strategies corresponding to the radicality of the analysis and aspirations. And in the case of the Arab revolutions, they were brutally crushed. From this point of view, the feminist movement was born from the ashes of the previous season of social movements. It has inherited some of its characteristics, but at the same time, it has taken a crucial step forward, especially if compared to movements like Occupy, the Indignados, or Taksim Square. The internationally coordinated adoption and reinvention of the strike, in particular, as its main form of struggle and as its political identity. Far from expressing a particularism, a partial perspective, within a broader process of mass mobilization, through women's strikes, the feminist movement is increasingly locating itself as as an international process of class formation. So in other words, it is not a feminist movement within a larger process of class formation. In a number of countries, the feminist movement is the process of class formation we are witnessing today. Now, of course, all of this is clearly a potentiality. In other words, so far the movement has continued to expand geographically and in terms of participation. But clearly there are also obstacles. First of all, there is a problem of strategy, once again. In other words, what are we going to do after organizing three transnational strikes? Are we going to manage to organize international meetings of the movement to discuss together about how to move forward, how to better coordinate the movement? Can we really overcome the national dimension and have a strategic transnational discussion together and so on? How to further pressure the labor movement and how to basically further contribute to redemocratization of the labor movement, to the to moving to the left, the labor movement, and so on and so on. So all of these are key strategic issues, and clearly things could also go very wrong. So far they haven't, so I'm a bit optimistic. We are talking, of course, of potentialities, but the political point of this paper is to say that speaking to the left, that if we want to discuss, if the left internationally wants to properly discuss how to reconstitute an internationalist framework of class struggle, how we can strengthen this, how can the struggle grow, and so on, my suggestion is that we should really begin with, first of all, the struggles that are already happening, not what we think we can create out of our minds. And secondly, perhaps we should look at the feminist movement. We should start from there, because this is the transnational struggle taking place today. This, of course, is again, just a potentiality. And the realization of the potential created by the new feminist wave requires, as I mentioned earlier, above all, a capacity on the part of the movement to reflect on itself, and therefore to think strategically at the same level in which it has already positioned itself through its practice, that of a class struggle, anti-systemic movement at the global level. And issues such as the consolidation of shared practices of struggle, the organizational sedimentation at the national and transnational level, and the universalization of the feminist movement through its expansion to the whole society and through its capacity to speak for the whole, or to transversality, to use the words of Veronica Gago, for example, are among the central issues that the feminist movement will have to discuss and face in the next period. Thank you.
Thank you for this interesting lecture. We have heard many relevant points. So since we have just one mic, I will just start with my own question and then listen for others. So my first question would be, so beside the concept of class, do you think there are other concepts or moments in Marxist theory that should be reconceptualized in order to make leftist theory in practice more open to a theoretization of gender oppression? For example, what comes to my mind is a certain ontologization of labor, certain praise of productivity, maybe also a perspective on capitalism as a progressive force of history, and also maybe the denial of a revolutionary potential to the open proletariat. So these are just some moments. You don't need necessarily to comment on that, but do you think there's other concepts besides class that should be reconceptual?
Yeah, so, okay, no, this is great because it gives me the opportunity to, for a little polemics with Silvia Federici. So, because I recently read some of her interviews in which she claims precisely that she cannot define herself as a Marxist because Marx thought that capitalism was a necessary step in the evolution of humanity and that it played a progressive role by creating the conditions for communism and so on. And she disagrees because she thinks that, she doesn't think that capitalism did play this progressive role and so on. She also has some elements, I think, of nostalgia for like peasant societies. Now, why the polemics? Because I think this is not Marx. So in other words, there are some, you know, Marx is a mess. You know, it's most of what he published, most of what he wrote are manuscripts that he never finished. He started more writings than he actually finished. Not only this, he was, there is also the problem of, you know, his manuscripts being then edited subsequently, and of course, the way in which they were edited was often problematic. And then there is the whole issue of the enormous amount of articles that Marx actually wrote and nobody reads. For example, he wrote, I think, around 400 articles for the New York Daily Tribune. I think this is the name of the magazine. And in these articles, he wrote about colonialism and all sorts of things. Nobody reads these articles, but if one reads this article, then it's a bit difficult to claim what some people claim about Marx. So, for example, that he never spoke about race or colonialism. This is not true. I think there are passages in Marx that seem to go in the direction of, of a philosophy of history in which capitalism is a necessary step that creates the condition of socialism by increasing productivity, establishing cooperation, and so on and so on. But we don't really find this in volume one of Capital, which is what actually Marx published. We can find it in the Grundrisse, which Marx didn't publish. And also we find several passages that actually contradict this, philosophy of history, teleology. So I would rephrase it in another way. So the issue is not whether capitalism was necessary or not. The issue is capitalism happened. And we are stuck in it, and we are here. And the fundamental question Marx is asking is, what is here within this new form of society that I'm trying to understand by working like a madman in the British Library? What is in this specific form of societies that actually opens the possibility for overcoming not only this form of society itself, but also all the previous horrors, historical horrors that humanity has experienced. So in other words, it's not that capitalism is a creation of Marx's thought, of Marx's mind. Capitalism is there, you know, whether you like it or not. But the issue is there something immanent to capitalism that we can actually, that opens new possibilities? So this is not a philosophy of history. This is being historical materialist. So you know, in other words, thinking about potentialities for struggle and for transformation that are given by history, by historical processes, and working with the historical processes in which we are all immersed. So from this viewpoint, I would agree with Federici that we do need to discard all you know, progressive, which you know, which are present, or progressive views of you know, the historical role that capitalism played, and that and we should you know, drop the Marxist traditions that basically develop this kind of philosophy of history. But this doesn't mean to drop Marx. It actually means to perhaps being more Marxist than the others. The other issues to revise, I mean, what is, again, there are, we should think about Marx as a construction site. So, you know, that we have, you know, discarded materials, half finished buildings, some buildings which are complete, like volume one and so on. And so as a laboratory, and we should precisely work with these elements. And also make some choices. Some, you know, for example, you know, the passages that may resemble to a philosophy of history, we may drop them. But there are other resources that we can actually use. So this is what, for example, eco-socialists are doing today. So there is a whole debate, because in Marx we do not find a fully fledged ecological critique of capitalism, but we do find some key elements. Not only of the direct critique of the environmental disasters caused by capitalism, but also some notions, so from you know, metabolic rift, or the way in which he understands the drive to increase the accumulation, so to produce more and more, and to open new market, that then we can use to explain why capitalism is incompatible with the ecological sustainability and so on. And so a series of others are doing this kind of work. So Jason Moore, Bellamy Foster, and other Malmo, and other eco-socialists. And a similar work is done also by social reproduction theorists, because again, Marx speaks about the reproduction labor power, but he doesn't speak about the work of those who reproduce labor power, so mostly women or feminized people, and he doesn't really develop the, you know, it doesn't really develop a notion of social reproduction that can be reconstructed starting from its categories, but that is not properly articulated in the in Marx's work. So in this case again, this is an element of revision or supplementing Marx with what is absent in order to explain, for example, the you know, phenomena like sexual oppression or gender oppression, and so on. And then similarly with the, you know, race and colonialism, although I would say after Anderson's book, Marx at the Margins, which you know, like he's a Marxologist, so he collected all the passages in which Marx examines the issue of colonialism and so on. It is a bit difficult to still sustain that Marx didn't deal with racism or colonialism. He actually did. And he actually also changed his mind. So in other words, he initially supported the idea that colonization could you know, have like a progressive effect in the sense of introducing capitalism in the society and so on. And then around 57, 58, he radically changed his mind. Why? Because of anti-colonial struggle. When he saw people struggling, and at that point he started writing in the New York Tribune, started writing precisely, obviously we are on the side of those who are fighting against the colonizers. I would like to see you at their place, and so on and so on. So, just to summarize, yes, I do think that there is there is a lot of work to be done. But there is some resources, some key resources and marks that can be used, some issues that may be left aside, and that Marx himself probably left aside. And I think the issue is, you know, to stop treating Marx like a dead dog, and to rather, you know, taking seriously, but also in a non-dogmatic way. So in other words, you know, he's not exactly a systematic thinker.
In terms more of a strategy of the third feminist wave, do you think that this wave of feminism should be autonomous from the formal organizations of the left, such as parties, unions, NGOs, etc.?
Okay, so I do think that the social movements should always be autonomous from organizations. In other words, social movements are always in excess with regard to pre-existing organizations. And being autonomous doesn't mean excluding, and doesn't mean not having a relation. And of course, we should also not be naive. Clearly, if there is a feminist movement, it's also because activists who belong to organizations have done the work and have done crucial work to make the movement possible. So movements do not, you know, there is an element of spontaneity, but there is also of, you know, hard organizing work that precedes the explosion of a struggle. At the same time, once a movement takes a mass dimension, it should have its own dynamic, and it should have its own, you know, organism, you know, its own tools of self-organization and self-representation, which should not be reducible to the, you know, coalitions of pre-existing organizations, and so on. Because basically, this would block. First of all, it would block the participation and the proper participation and of people who are coming to the movement, but who were not previously activists and who do not belong to organizations. And secondly, because there is an element of, in a sense, inertia even in the best organizations. There is an element of inertia that has to do with this, you know, the self-preservation of the organization. And this is understandable, but it also can play some conservative role. Just to give an example, to be more concrete, the first response of most labor unions to the feminist movement asking to go for a strike is no. And no has to do, of course, you know, with the difficulty of conditions, with legal issues, with all sorts of things. But it also has to do with the fact that strikes clearly are one of the most powerful tools that unions have. And there is clearly a tendency to monopoly. So in other words, to think then the strikes belong to labor organizations. Strikes do not belong to labor organizations. Strikes belong to the working class, to the class as a whole. And labor organizations are one organizational tool that can create the conditions for and call for strikes and so on. But they are not the only one. From this viewpoint, I think that, the movement should be autonomous. This does not mean, excluding activists belonging to parties or organizations, or not having a constant political conversation with labor unions, which actually should be involved in the movement, or with political organizations and so on, but starting from the assumption that at the end of the day, the decisions should be made by the movement through its own forms of self-organization.
I would like to know more about the women's strikes. Also, on a purely practical level, because we have seen that the strikes in Argentina, Spain, Italy, and elsewhere have been very massive. So I would like to know, for example, I don't know how many people were involved in the organization. Were those like legal protests or illegal demonstrations? Do you know if women who participated had some problem afterwards and so on?
So it is extremely variable. In the sense, it depends really on the country. Legal strikes were called in Italy, for example, in Spain. It was a legal work stoppage. I think it was called in Argentina, and it was called only by some unions in Chile, and also only by some unions in Argentina, and so on. In the United States, when we organized in 2017, clearly, I mean, we did have work stoppages, but they were illegal, also because in some countries, it is not legal to call for a general strike. So, for example, in the United States, in Germany, general strikes are forbidden by law. Political strikes are forbidden by law. You can only call for strikes within your own company or within your own individual workplace, and only in given circumstances. So when you are negotiating for a contract, for example, but not if you already have the contract. The Google walkout was illegal, for example. They just walked out without having any legal protection. The Glasgow strike I mentioned, it was in between, because it was basically organizing domestic workers, and some of them working in the public sector, they did have the right to strike, but others didn't. So it was a hybrid. So it really depends on the country. I recently did a dossier for Viewpoint Magazine, which is collecting various interventions from the various feminist movements about how they organize and so on. Some information can be found there. And also in terms of participation, it really depends on the country. So, we go from 6 million in Spain, hundreds of thousands in Italy on strike. In Chile, the educational sector went on strike. I don't know how many thousands of people went on strike. Most of women participated just to the march. They had two marches, one in the morning and one in the afternoon, to allow double participation. And it was, in Santiago, it was 300,000 people. It was the largest mass demonstration, street demonstration, since the end of Pinochet's dictatorship. So it was this level. So, it's difficult to give. In other countries, it's really just at the beginning. Like in Germany, it's really just the beginning of a process. In Belgium, it was quite big, but still the beginning. France, not great. The United States, we don't have a feminist movement at the moment, but we are working to see whether we can have it against the attack on abortion. So it is very uneven. But in some countries like Argentina, Spain, or Italy, I would say that the movement has the characteristics I was mentioning. So it has a class character, both in the composition of the movement, so who is actually participating, and in the slogans, demands, and in the forms of action, so calling for workplace strikes and so on.
Any questions?
Either you all agree or you all disagree.
So maybe we can continue the discussion tomorrow. So thank you for coming.